Hello. So I'm Harley Baldwin. I'm the VP of Design at Shell Games. And the request was to bring tips about game jamming and having a successful game jam. And I've got a lot of experience and I've got a lot of stuff to share, so I'm going to jump right in. So first, a little bit about me so that you know where I'm bringing this stuff from. I've been a professional game developer for some number of years, over 20. I started out at Her Interactive, and I worked at LucasArts for a long time, making Nancy Drew games and Vampire Diaries games and Star Wars games and a little bit of Indiana Jones. So I did that for about 10 years. And then I moved over to Crystal Dynamics, and I worked on some Tomb Raider games. I've also worked on Call of Duty, Rock Band, et cetera. These were mostly in design leadership roles. So I have a long history of making video games, and I have a lot of that to bring. But while I was working in design leadership, I had this book on my desk for about 5 years by this guy named Jesse Schell. It's called The Art of Game Design. If you haven't read it, you should. And if you have read it, you know what I'm talking about. And I used it all the time. I especially used it in training more junior designers and in helping me to solve design problems that at the moment seemed intractable. And we're talking about 100-plus person teams, so there were a lot of problems that did seem intractable. I used it all the time. So about 3 years ago, I got word that Jesse Schell was looking for a VP of design, and I wrote up my resume, and it must have still been burning when it hit his desk. And after some talking and some Skyping and some more talking and some flying out to Pittsburgh and discovering how wonderful Pittsburgh was, I joined Shell Games as the VP of design. A little bit about Shell Games. So Shell Games was founded by Jesse Schell. His career, he started out essentially as an Imagineer at Disney. He was the creative director for the VR studios at Disney. And then he came to Pittsburgh to teach at Carnegie Mellon. And while he was there, he discovered that there was still quite a bit of contract work. And so he started doing that on the side, and that grew and grew and grew into Shell Games, which has been around now for about 14 years. We are about 100 people. We're a full-service game design and development company. We do both our own internal IP and a great deal of client and partner work. We focus on entertainment and education. And we also do innovative interactive experiences. So that means a lot of VR, a lot of theme park work. If you've been to either of the Disney parks in the US, I guarantee you have played our stuff, even though I can't tell you what it was that we made. We do a lot of interesting work in the healthcare field in terms of helping researchers use games to find out if there is a way to have games improve the health of players or to teach doctors how to improve the health of their patients, that kind of stuff. So all over the place. We're very interested in new technologies, emerging technologies. Right now, we're very interested in VR and AR, and we do a lot of work there. This 100-person group, 100-plus person group, one of the ways that we stay ahead of this giant market with all of this, frankly, kind of crazy technology and change all the time is once a year, for a week, we stop, we put all the projects we're doing aside, we just stop. And everybody in the studio works on a passion project. We call this Jam Week. And people make teams, and people do this individually, some of it is, very big projects, and some of them are very small projects. So when I heard from the club that you guys needed some advice, I felt like I had maybe the best pool of advice you could possibly want. And so I sent out an email to the whole company, and I said, what do you want to tell these people? What should they know? What advice would you give? You can only give 3 pieces of advice. And I was flooded with advice. And so I've tried to sort it and bring it here. It was interesting that it aligns very well with what I thought I was going to put in the talk originally, and it aligns very well with some of the advice we've already gotten. I was pleased to see that. in order to contextualize the advice, I want to give you guys a sense of why we do Jam Week, right? Because think about it, 100 people, they're still getting paid. It's very expensive. Why do we do Jam Week? What could it possibly bring to us? Well, it brings us four things. One is, it allows us to explore concepts and ideas for new IPs that the studio can put together and sell, right? New intellectual property born in the studio. And it allows those new IPs to come from anybody in the studio. They don't just come from design leadership like a lot of studios. And that that has been very fruitful for us. Number two, it allows us a way to fail at innovation, which is the only way to actually innovate. If you sit down and you say, try something new, and if you fail, it's over, nobody's going to do that because everybody wants to succeed. If you sit down and you say, hey, you have a week to mess around with this thing and see what it could do and, you know, talk about what you discovered, that's a much richer space for people to play in, and you're going to get better results. So we need to be able to innovate because we're very interested in emerging technologies, and this is one of the ways that we push that. It is an excellent way to foster personal development and career development of our people. An animator may not only want to animate. Maybe an animator also wants to design a combat system. They don't have a chance to do that in their everyday lives, but they can try it out at Jam Week and discover whether it's something they really want to pursue. And sometimes they can show us that, like, oh, no, she's really got something, and she should be a combat designer. You know, we should find a position where she can do that. That sort of thing happens, and it happens not infrequently. And also, from my point of view as somebody who runs teams, most importantly, it fosters teamwork. It lets people work with people they haven't worked with before. It lets people work with disciplines that they haven't worked with before. It puts people in a high-pressure situation where they have to bring their best in terms of teamwork in order to succeed, and we can give them a structure to help them grow in that way. And so those are all the things that, all the reasons we do it as a company, and that gives some context to the advice I'm going to give you now. So these are some things that that Shell Games jammers say. Here's a whole little section of it. Polished tiny game is better than a bigger unfinished game. Come up with a game idea you can fully describe in a single non-compound sentence. It can all be summed up in keep it simple, which we've already heard today, right? But it's really important. Keep it simple. It should be the number one thing you guys think about this weekend. If you lose track of that, you're going to find that you're not satisfied with your outcome. If you do keep it simple, you can probably make something beautiful. Remember, when we are jamming, we have Jam Week. We have a week. You guys have 48 hours. So that's going to be incredibly important. So a lot of this talk is going to be about bursting your bubble and making you have a sad. And I'm sorry, but we might as well do that now. So let's just do that now. Okay, so this is a tiny game in terms of a professional game development. This is a tiny game, 12 to 24 weeks, 3 months to 6 months. Like, it's hard for me to even think of a game out there that was made in such a small amount of time, right? That's a tiny, tiny game. And this is a 48-hour game. You notice, when we go back and forth, I've got the same sections here. And the reality is that you need to fit the entire cycle of a tiny game, or a very large game. This could be a 4-year or 10-year long game. I've worked on games that had been in development for 8 years. You have to fit it all in this 48 hours. I'm going to give you a little bit of a heads up of a structure that can work for you. It's not the only structure that can work for anybody. But it is a structure that we tend to gravitate towards as professional game developers. When we are jamming, we just sort of stretch this thing out and figure out how long our actual time is, right? So our week looks like these basically 7 days, right? Okay, so let's go back to what Shell Games jammers say. Go with what's fun and don't get too attached. Take time to brainstorm separately, maybe together. Spend the first night coming up with a plan you all agree on. Make something. Don't try and spin your wheels on trying to figure out the perfect idea. Really, the crux of this is that execution trumps ideas, right? And I know that's not the narrative we have of game development. The narrative that we have of game development is there's a genius designer, and he or she comes up with the story and the context and everything, and then everybody just executes that, and it's awesome. And that's not the way that it works at all. It just isn't. The reality is that an excellent idea executed badly is a crappy game, and you're not going to like it, and no one else is going to like it. And a midland idea, a meh idea, executed very well, is actually going to be a really fun game. So don't spend so much time worrying about which idea or whose idea. Agree on an idea if you're working in a group, or just focus on one idea if you're working by yourself, that everybody can say, yeah, that's worth spending my time on, and then execute against that as well as you possibly can. That's going to get you the best experience, the most fun weekend, and the most fun game. And if you can have both of those things, that's all you can really want. So, here we are. We call this first section pre-production, and that's from 7 p.m. tonight till about midnight. And you have some goals here. Number one, you want to gold spike your pipeline. What does that mean? Well, gold spike refers to when the railroads were coming cross country and meeting, when they met in the middle, they used a gold spike, and then I'm sure they dug it up and put it in a museum somewhere to say, this is where the thing comes together, right? So what you're looking for with your pipeline gold spike is just everybody on the team can use the tool, can get their stuff into the game, can change the stuff. If you've got any kind of GitHub thing you're using or whatever, that you've got that set up, everybody understands it. That's one thing you need to do, that everybody's ready to go on the actual technology. Or if you're making a paper prototype or a board game or whatever, everybody understands what materials you have available, and you guys have some process by which people make changes to the game. You want to do a concept brainstorm. This is where we just talked about, you have to decide. This is where you decide. Everybody says your ideas based on whatever the theme of the game jam is. Talk about your ideas, you decide, and then everybody agrees that that's what you've decided you're going to try to go for. So you pick that concept. Some advice for that. A lot of times in game development, we call that the MVP, the minimum viable product. And really what that means is the smallest possible thing that can explain your idea to a player. You're not going to make the whole game that you've envisioned. The smallest possible slice you have that can explain what your experience should be like to the player. So you're not going to make Call of Duty, I promise. You're not going to make Minecraft. You're not going to make Angry Birds. You might, if you're lucky and things go very well, and your team works very well together, make one level of Angry Birds. And that is perfect. That is an excellent achievement. So when we talk about scope, that's the kind of scope we're talking about, is that kind of focus and that kind of commitment to a single small idea. The other thing you want to do before midnight is decide your first prototype goals, right? So in the morning, what's going to happen is you're going to start working, and you're going to have all kinds of ideas about how you can meet this concept that you guys have decided you want to do. What you want to do is fail fast, and so you're going to have more than one prototype. Probably you want maybe four prototypes in that morning, but you want to know what you're working on first, that first prototype, so you can hit the ground running. As soon as everybody shows up, or as soon as the first person shows up, you're just going towards that thing. You all know what that prototype is. Everybody's moving towards it, right? And then shell games jammers say, sleep, 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 sleep. I couldn't fit all the sleeps on here. This is only the best sleeps, right? And that is counterintuitive to us, I know, because it was counterintuitive to me. But, oh man, after you do those things, go to sleep. I keep banging this thing. I'm sorry if it's popping. Just do it. And also eat. And there are really good reasons for that. Certainly, there's a lot of research that says if you don't get any sleep, that your functions are harder to access, your social ability goes down, you can't figure out how to use software that you otherwise could use in your sleep. And all of that is true, but that's not really the reason that we tell people sleep. The real reason we tell people to sleep is because your unconscious mind is very good at solving problems that your conscious mind gets stuck on. So you set up the problem, right? Between 7 and 12, that's basically what you're doing. And then you go to sleep and you give your unconscious mind some time to work on it. And you'll wake up, I guarantee, with some great ideas about how to solve the problems that you set for yourself yesterday. That's why we say sleep. This is so important that it's actually got its own page in Jesse Schell's book. And we actually even do it in the office. Like, again, we're struggling with an intractable problem. There's couches, and we just go lay down on the couch. We don't actually sleep, but we relax. We let our unconscious mind go into it. We do a little bit of free association. Pretty soon somebody's saying, well, what if we put the turtle in the box? Oh, that would solve the problem that nobody knows what's in the box because everyone's seen a turtle, blah, 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 whatever, right? So there's that. Also, really do eat and try to eat reasonably well. Staying up more than you're used to takes a lot of calories. It's exhausting. Thinking and collaborating, also exhausting. And if you're also starving and you're not feeding your body, not just calories, but like decent calories of a good quality, you're young enough now probably that it you won't notice it immediately, but it will affect the quality of your work. Okay, so we are on to the prototyping phase, phase two. Your goals, find the fun, fail faster, get to first playable. First playable is basically the very first time that you can see a little bit about what it is that this game could become, this prototype could become, right? It's the first time that people are like, oh, I understand, I do this and this happens. I do this and this happens. Oh, is there any more there, right? It's not the whole thing, but it gets you a sense of like, yeah, we're on the right track. That's what you're trying to do, and you're trying to do that by Saturday at 1 p.m. Super, super short timeline. But it will be helpful, I promise, if you can do that. Next, the alpha phase. All companies define alpha slightly differently, but very generally what alpha means is that you can play a version of the game from start to finish. What we think of it as, and we have actually a very specific definition, is the core loop. The core loop is, as a player, I can look at the game, I can figure out what inputs are available to me, I can choose one of those inputs, the game understands my input, gives me a reaction, and that gives me new information with which to make a new choice. And that could either, that works with both a board game and a digital game, right? So that's what we consider the core loop. And that's that choice that you're making around between, you know, a tenth and every 5 seconds, depending on the pace of your game. You really want to have the core loop settled in your alpha phase. And that happens Saturday at 6 p.m. because you're getting ready to playtest. And playtest is incredibly important. We just talked a lot about the relationship between the designer and the player. You can't know what your relationship with your player is going to be unless you playtest. And I guarantee you that you have made mistakes that you had no idea you've made. And I can guarantee you that because in the 20-some years that I've been doing this, I have never once gone to a playtest and had everything come out the way that I thought it was going to. Literally every single time a player has done something and I'm like, why would they do that? I didn't think of that. How? But this, we had thought of everything. We watched 17 other people do that and they didn't do that. Oh, that's going to be a real problem if people keep doing that. You got to play test. You just have to. You can't be in the heads of all of your players. All you can do is present them with your best guess and they're going to react as they do. Okay, so your goal is to get to a playtest at 6 p.m. on Saturday. Playtest each other's stuff or go outside and find somebody and drag them in here and make them play your stuff. Doesn't matter. It's important when you're playtesting not to tell them what to do. It's the most important thing. So if they say, what do I do? You say, what do you think you should do now? And if they say, what is that thing? You say, what do you think that thing is? And if they get really frustrated, you say, would you like some help now? And then you give them one single hint and you step back. Because what you're really there for is to find out, do they understand the game and can they make progress by themselves? Because if they can't, you know, you've got some work to do. And if you tell them what to do and how to solve it, then you'll never get that information. Okay, so what is this one about? Jammers say. Oh, yes. So this is about iterate on Sunday, don't forget sound, blah, blah, blah. Schedule for completing the single level halfway through your game period. This is about what we call the halfway rule. So a few years ago, we were having a conversation, and we were talking about the fact that some games that we make that have generous resources and incredibly talented teams with lots of experience aren't really very good when they're done. And some games with very small amounts of resources and really constricting rule sets they had to adhere to, somehow they are really good. And why is that? Is there any data that we could pull that would tell us why this is happening? And we did a lot of data analysis. And one thing that really stood out was those games that had their core loop working halfway through the development cycle had a much, much better chance of being good games that got critical acclaim or that players generally rated 85 or higher than those games which took the entire development cycle and said, I want this feature and 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 this feature. Oh, I don't have any time to polish, right? And I have no time to react to what my playtest says my players liked and didn't like or didn't understand. So we made this halfway rule, and it's a little draconian, and we try to offset that by letting teams sort of determine a little bit for themselves, what does that core loop really mean for this game? For some games, it's every feature. For some games, it's only a subset of features, but it is that core experience of the game, right? But since we started doing this, the average, I want to call it Metacritic because I'm old school, but just sort of the average score that we're getting from our players has gone way up. Because yes, the games are smaller, and they're more focused, and they're more polished, and more people have played them, and we've already found more problems and fixed them, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the reason that we have the halfway rule, and I encourage you to think about the halfway rule this 48 hours when you're right around here. Okay, so beta phase. What beta means to most companies is feature complete, content complete. So all of the mechanics that you're going to write in code are in the game, and all of the art and music and voice lines and text, etc., are also all in the game. Everything's in there, and it all works, and you can play all the way through it from beginning to end. That's beta, and that's when the real work starts. There is a saying, especially in AAA game development, that you do 90% of the work in the last 10% of time, and that's absolutely true. I'm sure you guys have heard the stories about crunch, and that absolutely does happen, and it happens because we get to beta, and we look at it, and we're like, oh, we have to fix everything. And so we're not going to sleep for 1 to 6 months. This is a good time, because you've done a playtest and you know what people do and don't understand, to add a tutorial if you need one, and probably you need one. Tutorials, I think tutorials are a little bit ham-handed way of teaching mechanics that you didn't realize people weren't going to understand. And you know, that's probably true. That doesn't mean that my games don't have them. Almost every game I've ever made has a tutorial because there isn't the very generous time that you really want to do that in an elegant way. And so you do end up adding some tutorials. And that's okay. You'll learn from it next time, and you'll know how to teach that next time, and then you'll have to tutorialize something else. And also integrating final assets. So in your playtest, nobody knew that in order to blow up the star, they had to hit the big green button, and then somebody said, what if we make it red? And like, hey, people will know to hit the big red button, and so you change that asset so that the button is red, and okay, great, now this is the time to integrate it, right? So you want to have that done, all of that, do-do-do-do-do, Sunday at 3 p.m., because now you're going to do the thing where you upload the final game. Warning, the Global Game Jam servers get real slow around this time, like real slow. So be really disciplined about that 3 p.m. deadline. Because if you're not, you may find that you are in a horrible loop where you're trying to connect or everything is too slow and you're not going to make it and et cetera, et cetera. And you don't want that. And also you want to set up your demo, right? So other people can come play, and you can do that thing where, hey, look, we made a game, and you can talk about it, et cetera. You want to have all that ready so that you can relax for that final push. And hopefully there's cake because it would be sad if the cake was a lie. If you have judges, you know, you want to do your demo to jammers and judges, it's not a bad idea, if you can, to have a clean shirt that you put on right before then. We can get a little stinky when we jam. That's reality. That's human-centered design. Okay, so there you go. There's your entire life cycle. Super concrete, hopefully, and what that looks like for 48 hours. Ooh. So I just told you a lot of really, really bad news. And I'm sure it's discouraging. And also I wanted to use this GIF because, wow, look how sad. But there is some good news, right? You came here to make something, and you came here to tell the world about the way that you see it in some way, in some mechanical way. And there are some really great opportunities out there, and you may make what you set out to make, and you may not. I guarantee you'll learn something either way, and that what you learn will be incredibly valuable to you as a game designer, and also if you decide to be a doctor or a mayor, it will be valuable, I promise. So, I'm going to tell you some stories about ways that this worked out in people's favor. So, I Expect You to Die is a game that Shell Games released right before Christmas. It's a VR game in which you play a spy who's just at that moment when the villain is just about to kill you, and you have to figure out how to get out of his nefarious clutches, right? It's done very well for us. We're very proud of it. And I think I can show you. Yes, here's the trailer. I'll let it speak for itself. Ooh, I need sound. Nope, that's not the right sound. Oh, it's some of it. I'm not going to worry too much about the sound. So, I Expect You to Die as an internal IP. It was born at Shell Games. It was developed at Shell Games. Every single element of it has been made at Shell Games. We did the voice recording. Anthony Daniels came to our studio and did the voice recording, which was a kind of a cool moment. And it started out as a game jam game. One of our senior programmers wondered, when he was playing with the very, very early first version of the Oculus Rift, wow, there is no way to sort of get your hands in here and control anything. I wonder if I can just do something with a mouse, because everybody knows how to use a mouse, and like we're all really good at clicking and scrolling, and you don't have to think about it. Is there a way that I could make something that just feels like hands in VR there, just one hand? And so he did a jam week on it, and it was just picking up, you know, cylinders and pyramids and boxes and being able to look at them and move them away from you and bring them close and stack them on one another. And it was so cool. It was really inspiring. And so people started thinking, well, what kind of universe could you make this out of? And it was very intuitive, and the next thing we knew, we were making I Expect You to Die. So this is probably 4 years ago, Game Jam, and it turned into something really great. So there's one story for you about how being very focused and disciplined with your scope and your mechanics can turn into something great. Another one that is not about Shell Games. Anybody here played Superhot? Anybody here played Superhot on the Rift? Okay, so Superhot's a pretty good game, and it started out as a game jam for a week-long shooter game jam in 2013. And they basically just asked the question of, what would a shooter be like if the enemies and bullets could only move when you were moving? And it turned out that it's pretty interesting. And so they made like one level and they released it and that was pretty good. And so then they decided, well, we'll just keep doing this. And so they made a web game and they released it, and you can play it today if you want to. Just go look for Super Hot. And it's pretty good. It's pretty interesting. But it didn't really take off. And then the Oculus Rift came out and the Oculus Touch came out, and they had their medium. And I tell you today that Super Hot, it may be the best experience on the Oculus Rift. It's fantastic. You feel like you're doing gun kata like a kung fu master. It's amazing. And I'm not like an athletic person, but it makes me feel like I own that universe. And it does it very, very well. So both of those things came from game jams. They just focused on one question, tried to solve that question, and they did a great job. So there's that. Little bit more advice. You're going to do your game jam. You're going to be tired. You're going to go home. You're going to sleep. Then I want you to get back together with your team and your club, and I want you to do a retrospective. Anybody know what a retrospective is? It's very simple, right? So you make this thing with four axes. And over here, you have the game and the process that you used to make the game. And up there, you went what went well and what you need to improve. And you get in a room, and you're forthright and considerate with one another. And you talk about what could have been better in the game and what was really great in the game and what could have been better in the process and what was really great in the process. And you write it all down, and that's how you learn from it. We do this with every game that we make, and we do it multiple times in the development. And it helps our teams and our games get better every single time. I've never been to a retrospective that wasn't both incredibly painful and incredibly useful. So I want you guys to do this, because even if the game that you make is total crap, and it might be, I've made some total crap games in game jams, I will tell you that right now, this is something that you can take home and that will stick with you and be useful. So last thing that shell games jammers say. A lot of, find something that you like, try something new, etc. But what they're really saying is have fun. You definitely should do that this weekend. Let others have fun with you. Invite people to have fun, both making the game with you and playing the game. Have fun playing their games. This is a 48 hours that will be an excellent investment in whoever it is that you are next year. And also, please send me your games. I'm Harley at shellgames.com. I would love to see them. Thank you.